Hey guys, you're welcome to WTS, WGS. What they say versus what God says. My name is Mafeng Kim. So on today's episode, we'll be looking at go back home. Go back home. Think about this. When you were a child, anytime you got into trouble, who did you run to or who did you call? For me, my most frequent option was call daddy. I didn't get saved really early, so I wouldn't have thought to pray, but I knew that if I could just call daddy, I'd be safe. So when I got saved and got to know that God is my father, it gave me a mindset that God is a father who protects, keeps, and sustains his children. One thing I have repeatedly reminded us of on the podcast is the fact that man is spirit, that he has a soul, and that he lives in a body. The body is a house, a tent of sorts that houses the real man. And when man fell in the Garden of Eden, a lot of things went wrong. Man's spirit, the real him, lost access to God. Now, in the law of Moses in the Old Testament, the sacrifices that, you know, were afforded, made of the blood of bulls, sheep, and goats, were simply to cover the sins of the children of Israel in order to give them access to God, you know, some form of relationship. Now, at Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, salvation became legally available. And from that point on, man had access to God by the blood of Jesus. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Now Christ, as the only begotten Son of God, as stated in the verse above, came to earth and died to bring many sons into the family of God, bringing many sinners unto salvation. This helps us see John 1:12 in, you know, a better light. Because it says, "But as many as have received him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name." Verse 13 says, "Which were born, not of blood, nor of the will of flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God." So in the ordinance of God, it is no longer Jesus, the only begotten Son of God, but Jesus, the firstborn among many brethren, all sons of God. We see this referenced repeatedly in the New Testament. An example is Colossians 1:18, which says of Christ that he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. He is the first and we come after him. We're his body. 1 John 3 verse 1b says, "Behold what manner of love the Father had bestowed upon us that we should be called the sons of God." Verse 2 says, "Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is." Guys, we are sons of God. We're members of his family. We have his life. Now, the family of God is a kingdom. And he is the king of that domain. He rules in sovereignty. But he is also Father. You know, Jesus said to his disciples, "I go back to my Father and yours." So as much as he is the Lord of hosts, the King of heaven, and is the God of all, he is my Father. He is the father of every man, woman, or child who turns to him and surrenders to his lordship. Now, some people grew up with fathers with whom they could hardly relate. Like there was never any base for a close or intimate father-child relationship. At best, they had a relationship filled with acts of service, meeting of very basic needs, and awkward silences. Do you have socks? Yes. Do you have food? Yes. It means I'm a good father. And that's all. Even more sadly, you hear stories of people who have been molested, abused, and traumatized by their own fathers. It makes it hard for them to relate to God as a loving father. When you tell someone like that God is a father, they will despair. Because in their logic, if their earthly fathers were wicked, if their earthly fathers were irresponsible, if their earthly fathers were harsh in judgment, and rash. God must be that same way as well. But no. You know, it's not their fault. It's all they know to relate to a father. And instead of God's fatherhood being a thing of comfort, it becomes a stumbling block to their faith. Even after accepting God's salvation and growing in the faith, sometimes we expect God to treat our shortcomings pretty much the same way our earthly fathers would. Punishment, retribution, judgment. Thus, when we fall or fail or falter, we yield to the urge to run away from God. If you think that way, see, you're not alone. We have countless people who, for one reason or the other, choose to run away from God rather than face what they perceive to be His impending wrath. I've been there. But I'm also here to tell you, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Hebrews 4:16. It says, come boldly. The door is open. He has given you that access. Making us His sons, right, expresses the height of love that He has for us. He shared His life with us. It shows you He loves you and I. Remember this. God is Lord, He is Master, He is King, but He is also Abba, Father. Romans 8:15 says, for ye have not received the spirit of bondage again unto fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption whereby we cry, Abba, Father. So if you're ever in doubt, the Spirit of God bears witness to our spirits that we as believers are the sons of God and are joint heirs with Christ. So, though we submit to God pretty much the same way a servant would, our sonship is our position, and our servanthood, or our servant's posture, is our disposition. So you see, God, as our Father, always wants us to come to Him first. In joy, in pain, in sadness, in trouble, in any circumstance, come to Him first. Though man's natural impulse is to flee from God, His holy presence and His perceived impending judgment, that is not His plan. He started with Adam. Adam, where are you? He said, I'm hiding because I am naked. Don't hide from God. Let the righteousness that God avails you allow you to stand before God without any inferiority, and even before the devil without any sense of condemnation. You're a child of God. Your walk with God has not started until you begin to see God as your Father. You begin to see yourself through His eyes. You'll pray differently. You'll see the Word and its realities differently. It won't be about a religion. It would be about your relationship. God will not evaluate your performance in order to decide whether you remain in His family or not. He's your daddy. And you're staying. It's not like an office where you have to carry out annual, biannual, or monthly appraisals and assessments to determine your productivity levels and whether you'll be allowed to keep your job or get fired. No. A beloved child, when in trouble, does not run away from home, but rather runs to God. Trust God enough to go back home. What is the problem? Tell Him. Cry to Him. How do you feel? Tell Him. He is a father you will never outgrow. Don't try to feel too hard or too grown for God. Don't try to prove the strength of your armor. Ever before you have to go to battle to prove the cracks in your armor, tell God the problem. Because in God, you'll find help. In God, you'll find comfort. In God, you'll find grace and mercy. In God, you are whole. So what is it that you think is too bad that you cannot come to God with? What is so horrid, so sad, so dirty that you think God cannot handle it? Let me give you the 411. God can handle it. And He will not only handle it, but He will cause that situation to be for your good. God is on your side, ever ready to take responsibility for your growth and development as a loving father. The question is, will you let Him? You don't even have to meet Him halfway. He is right at your door. You just have to let Him in. So come on and pray this prayer with me. Say, Heavenly Father, thank you for your love and the gift of fatherhood towards me. Help me to make the most of this opportunity. I commit myself to your care, trusting in your love for me and trusting that your plans for me are of good only and not of evil. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. We've come to the end of today's episode. If you were blessed by this message, don't forget to leave a comment in the comment section. Guys, please reach out to us at the email in the description box, wtswgs@gmail.com, and we will get a paid copy of the Apocalypsis to you for free. You can follow the previous episodes on YouTube, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, or Google Podcasts. Subscribe to the channel, guys. If you haven't, subscribe, like the podcast, share with all your friends, leave a comment, forward the link on all your social media handles. Thank you so much, guys. Bye.